I started printing it in the 70s, actually, but I don't have any of those shows right now because I don't even know where they are. So a lot of the stuff was done when I felt like I was in the movement, and the movement carried me and gave me the setting for how to think about what to do and the issues to take up. And one of the nicest things about having a movement at the time was there were a lot of interconnections with other communities. So I was able to do things like this when we collaborate with a poet and a poem. And if you read this, you can see how things haven't changed much since 1986 when Ronald Reagan was president. This one was with the group, with Andres?
Yes.
He was putting together a portfolio to raise funds for I think it was for trying to normalize relations with Cuba. We were pushing for that. So that's the image I came up with. I decided there to do kind of a modern graphic design look rather than the more passionate one, because I wasn't personally involved in the movement myself, but I did want to lend my support. So I used some like transparent inks and stuff to show that the U.S. military-industrial complex, how threatening it is to the island of Cuba. This one pretty much speaks for itself. It was to celebrate Malcolm X's birthday, and a lot of artists are using the letter X and stuff, and I wanted to do something a little different, and but also with a sort of Asian perspective, because Malcolm X, just shortly before his death, became more of an internationalist. And I think that was when he became much more of a threat. And that, my own feeling is that that contributed to his assassination. So this is, to me, is the picture of U.S. imperialism. All the countries, so it was a time when I connected international violence with domestic violence and what's happening to people here. So, I was always struck by these planes that drop these bombs. Like, I don't know how many they drop more tonnage in Vietnam than all of World War II put together. Napalm, all this, these kind of fascist, horrible things. So I put all the countries that, since World War II, that the U.S. were involved in regime change, coups, and whatnot. And then, of course, all the U.S. cities that got police brutality. And then, being kind of a student of history myself, I really liked this quote from Malcolm X about history, how important it is. And jumping ahead a bit, this was, I went to Standing Rock in support of the struggle there, and along with the delegation, it was mostly Asian women. And so we wanted something to show that, the Asian community is also behind them. So this is the Chinese word for water. And I incorporated the four directions, which is a common theme both in Native arts and Chinese art as well. So these are all happening in the 90s. And so by then, the movement had started to sort of dissipate, and I sort of really missed that. I felt a little like I was drifting a bit. So I started searching on my own for meaning, like how to do my art now. And so I looked into indigenous cultures, and I studied more like Buddhism and Asian spirituality. And at first I couldn't come up with any kind of like Buddhist art or stuff because I did not want to do traditional Buddhist iconography. And I wanted to practice it and see what I came up with. So at this point, it hadn't come out yet. But I did look back into myself and see what are the connections to my own culture and the past. And so I wanted to look at China, pre-imperial China, and I mean imperial, not just European imperialism, but China itself became an empire, and that changed drastically, because before that, there were mostly a lot of independent kingdoms and tribal groups even, and at that time, they were still very much in touch with nature and animals, had a strong connection. So the spirituality played a big role in how they look at things. So the rulers of the Shang Dynasty in about 2000 BC, they were conducting ritual and human sacrifices. You know? So, you know, I always wondered what they were thinking then. So, because I feel I've internalized a lot of that, and even though I'm not really a scholar of ancient Chinese art, I felt like an affinity with the feelings and the art of the times. And so I literally felt that, you know, my ancestors were talking to me through me, and I felt these things that speak to a different vision of the world and life. And here it's pretty obvious I took a lot of cues from native artists from the North Pacific Northwest. When I traveled there a few times, I was just really struck by the art. I felt some kind of affinity. And so it sort of came very naturally when I started coming up with images. This is more recent. These are all more recent. This is a combination of these characters you see here are taken from coaching papers. Coaching papers were basically cheat sheets that, let me back up a little bit. And, the Chinese weren't allowed to come here, to immigrate here. So a few who came to work on the railroads ended up staying, and they could bring their own family, their direct line of children, but not anybody else. So after the earthquake in 1906, a lot of the records were burned. So a lot of Chinese took advantage of that situation and offered to buy themselves a status of, and I think, I'll be your son, you know, give me the write it down as official papers and all that. So somehow I think the immigration department got into that and started giving these really incredibly difficult tests. You know, absurd questions like, how many steps were needed to your father's house? I think I remember something like that, right? So people started making these cheat sheets with all the questions and stuff, and they passing them around certain dishes. And then I heard about the Underground Railroad quotes, how these quotes helped to give information to escape slaves and how, that and coaching papers, it seemed like a natural connection. So I started doing this. And I've always wanted to look for multinational solidarity among the French people. So I thought this would be a good chance to do something. So as I got more into like Buddhism and spirituality, I still couldn't kind of let go of the struggle for justice and equality and stuff, but I was just taking a different approach. So I started first by just going into animals and my relationship with them, and I realized that how much our thinking needs to be decolonized, such as, you know, man having dominion over nature, which always ends up in exploitation, really. And so that kind of feeds into the environmental movement, and I thought, well, to change things objectively, we need to change them all within ourselves, too. So I started looking at nature a little differently, and looking at animals as equals. So I did a lot of animal imagery. You can see some of the loose ones in there, too. And some of them were just kind of lighthearted and not real serious. But mainly all of it was to sort of put myself in equal with animals. And this one, when the whales started washing ashore earlier this year, I felt so bad about it. And I saw pictures of little kids climbing all over them, and people were taking selfies with it. I thought, God, you know, how much more disrespectful can it be? And so I said, what can I do? You know, I can't go out and yell at those people. I don't want to do that. I said, well, I feel so bad about the whale, which I'm not really now starting to think of as a relative, taking on Native American ideas too. What can I do for this relative who just died? So I said, well, as an artist, what I can do is restore his dignity. And beauty is really a good way to grieve. It really eases the pain. So I made him, it looks like he's kind of floating on the sand, so I didn't want him to be kind of like sinking into the land, but he's in the spiritual world, spirit world now. And then I put the ship in the back because when I'm on the beach a lot, I see these ships going by all the time, and when it's kind of close to this, I think it's like, well, this is capitalism, you know, the trade and money making has to go on regardless. I mean, they don't even care about the whale, they don't even know the whale is there. Who knows, they might have hit it, injured it. So it's kind of,
part this year, I finally, the Buddhism part started with the same thing, and I was able to create some stuff. And this is the Buddhist idea of a no self, which actually for a lot of Western thinking, including my own, is very difficult to kind of grab. What do you mean no self? You know, so, and then, you know, at my age now, I think a lot about death and dying in a very natural way. I'm not afraid to say it or offend you. And I think a lot of it is because we cling to this idea of the self. We're afraid to let it go of what's going to happen when we don't have this body anymore. So that's what terrifies you. But actually, in Buddhism, the self, there's no really such thing, because it's just really a comic coming together of all these different things. And you have a consciousness which makes you aware of what's going on, but there's not necessarily a permanent fixed self. And I thought once I let go of that idea, then I feel like I'm less afraid of death. And life goes on anyway. It goes through different forms. It comes, you know, when I work in my garden a lot, I see plants die, and next year they're all back again. So something goes continuous, even when the form changes. This is pretty much the standard. You're always solid. And how something beautiful comes out of a muck, dirty and muffy and ugly. And I wanted to show the beauty of it through color. You can probably tell I like color a lot. And the colors of the lotus are so sensual, in which, again, it's not, sensuality is not always sexuality. It can be something of its own. And it's very wholesome, pretty much pure. And that's why I like to be with the lotus. This is also kind of a decolonization culturally. I want to say the snakes do not represent evil. They're actually beautiful animals. And in a lot of our mythologies, snakes are very positive. I also wanted to pay tribute to Islamic art, given our times now, and everybody's so crazy about it. So when I studied Chinese history, I noticed there's a lot of connection with the Middle East, Persia, and especially like the blue color. I came into the famous Chinese like blue and white porcelain. A lot of the blue came from Persia. They had cobalt in it, blue a lot. And you know, sort of recommend designs rather than too representational, because there's a running point, you know, you always want to have patterns and things like that. Not too representational. So that's kind of a mixture of Chinese aesthetics and Persian. And then I'm kind of back to full circle, and I went to the climate strike a few months ago, I guess it was. So I took a lot of photos. Actually, my other platform was photography. I started out with photography from the school, and I wanted to, because I saw what a role photography had played with the Vietnam War. And all the civil rights movement, these photos that hit the newspapers are really moving a lot of people, which you don't find much now, because, you know, I guess the people up there know the value of photography, because, I mean, who reads the newspaper every day? You don't see nothing in the room about these worlds. So anyway, so a lot of times, like when I went to Standing Rock, and also to a lot of the demonstrations that followed, I was photographed. So this is one of the reasons. I like the sign, what it says in the beginning in particular. According to the land, you know, when you're talking to Native people, they talk about land. And, so I turned it into a print. It's not a silkscreen, by the way. It was Photoshop.